guys. All right, time for take two. Let's try that again. Hope you can hear me better now. Okay, so I'm Megan, and I'm coming to you live from the Arizona Science Center, where Camp Innovation is taking over Facebook Live. This week in Camp Innovation, we've been exploring surviving in space. So we've been talking about how we get to space, how we come back to space, and the things that we do while we're there. Now, today's demonstration is going to be about bionics and robotics. So when we send people to space, right, we have these cool spacesuits that allow astronauts to explore different areas. But sometimes there are still places we can't quite get to yet, or there are materials that we just don't want to touch with our hands, even if we have those gloves on. So if we come into that kind of situation, for instance, like Mars, we can't send people to Mars quite yet, then we need to send robotics and bionics up there to be able to do that work for us. Now, the best example I can think of for this is the Mars rover. So we're sending the Perseverance up pretty soon. And part of the Perseverance's mission is going to be to collect samples from Mars that could potentially come back so we could actually start studying the surface of Mars with actual samples. So in the past, our rovers, we've relied on them to take pictures and do analysis themselves. But now the Perseverance is going to come equipped with a robotic arm and a laser drill so that they can pull some of those samples and potentially bring them back to Earth. So then we could get a better feel for what is actually down the surface of Mars and not have to rely on photographs. So if we're going to say that this is our Perseverance here, when we're designing the Perseverance, we have to think about, first of all, how are they going to move around on Mars? So we have these big wheels that help her to move around over that rocky terrain. But then the next big thing that we need to think about is how are they going to be able to do their job? So often the Mars rover will have a camera so they can take pictures, and then this one is also going to be equipped with that robotic arm and that laser drill. So when we're designing something like a robotic arm or a bionic arm, we need to think about different types of science. Okay, so we need to have our engineer who knows how to create the best materials, but we also need to have maybe a human biologist who understands how the human body works, okay? So for instance, if I'm creating my bionic hand here, and this one is human power, this is to just be able to reach something that maybe I don't want to touch with my bare hand, but I still need to understand how the human body works in order to do this, okay? So the first thing that we're gonna think about is that internal structure. How do our hands keep their structure? And those would be our bones, right? So if we don't have our bones, we're just kind of mush. So for my bones here, I've got these straws, and those are helping to provide structure so that these pieces of cardboard, my skin, my external, it's not just flopping around, okay? Then inside of my straws, I have the connective tissue. If I don't have connective tissue, then those bones are just gonna be floating around inside my body and they still aren't providing much structure. So we have ligaments that connect those bones together. And then down at the bottom, I have an example of a tendon. Now a tendon connects a bone to muscle, okay? So we need to have our bones, we need to have our connective tissue, our ligaments and our tendons. And then we also need to have that muscle, because if we're just bones, maybe they're structured, but we can't do anything. So I'm gonna use my hand as the example of muscle in this case, because this is a hand-powered bionic arm. Okay, and so we're gonna say this is, my hand is gonna be the muscle inside of, say, the palm of this hand. And I'm gonna use my tendons to connect the bones to the muscle. And when we're talking about muscles, there are two primary functions that a muscle around a joint can have. And that is to be a flexor, to make it tense up and close that joint, or to be an extensor, to release that joint. So if I'm saying that my hand inside the palm here is the flexor muscle, it's going to flex this joint closed, then I'm going to tense
nice.
It and pull it closed.
Moving closer to see it.
Okay. Now, I've got it closed, but my problem is I don't have anything to release it, right? So if we just had those flexor muscles to close the joint, there wouldn't be a way to open it again. And that's what our extensors are for. So I've got these rubber bands on the back of my fingers here, and those are going to be our extensor muscles. They help the joint to release, okay? So then if I let go, instead of just staying in that closed position, which would happen if you didn't have these extensors, they do pop up again and they close. And they open, that joint opens. And it's important to understand all of that biology and all of that anatomy in order to make this function. Otherwise, we would just be putting pieces together and we wouldn't know the best way to create that structure. Okay? So it's important for astronauts to have a solid understanding of different areas of science in order to be able to create these different structures and these different tools to help them do their jobs. Now, if we were going to use this as an example of how an astronaut might use it, say I have this piece of Mars material here, okay? But I don't know what's in it, I don't want to touch it, and I'm not sure that my gloves are going to be a strong enough material to protect my skin, so I'm going to use a Bionics tool instead, right? So then I could potentially use this tool and use my flexor inside to close the fingers around it so that I can move this material around. Maybe get it under a microscope or something. Or I can push it away, right? And so I'm using that same understanding of how the human hand works to make my bionic hand work as well. Now, if we wanted to make this a robotic and make it function on its own, what we would do is then inside here, where my hand was, we would create a robotic system that could recreate how the muscles of the hand work. And that would be another time when we would share our results, right? We have this product, and we've gone through our engineering design process, we've brainstormed, we've used information that we've had, we've planned it out, we've created it. Now we need to share with another scientist and say, okay, I have this prototype, how do I make it function from a bionic, which is still kind of human powered, into a robotic that functions on its own? And in that case, once I do that, once I create this as a robotic, then I can attach it to my Mars rover. And my rover, then, I can send it up to Mars. I know that it's going to function because I've tested it here on Earth. I've shared those ideas with other scientists and they've shared back with me. And so I know that this is going to be able to go to Mars and take those samples that I need it to. Okay? So that's what goes into designing a bionic and robotics. And so we have to talk about all those different types of science to make them all work together. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for hanging out with me today, guys. I am so glad that we got this working, and I look forward to seeing you all again. As always, if you have questions, if you're interested in finding out more, you can always visit azscience.org. Thank you so much. Bye.
Bye-bye.